Dear Reverend Clergy, Dr. Skedros, Dean of Holy Cross School of Theology, distinguished faculty, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the Mary J. Harris Center for Byzantine Art and Culture and the New York Life Center for the Study of Hellenism in Pontus and Asia Minor, it is my pleasure to welcome you to the second event of the Boston Byzantine Music Festival. Last night, we focused on the art of chanting. Today, we turn our attention to the non-ecclesiastical musical traditions of the Eastern Mediterranean and their close ties to the Byzantine heritage of sacred chant. It is my great honor to introduce to you my fellow Thessalonian, Kyriakos Kalaitzidis, a composer, master oud player, musicologist, and artistic director and co-founder of the world-renowned Enchordes Musical Ensemble, which we will have the opportunity to enjoy in a concert at the Maliotis Cultural Center tonight at 7 o'clock. Having earned a PhD in Byzantine musicology at the University of Athens, under the guidance of the eminent musicologist Grigorios Stathis, Dr. Kalaitzidis is considered one of the most important musical scholars in the field of modal secular music of the post-Byzantine era. In 1986, he began a study of the oud and is now one of the most distinguished performers and teachers of the instrument in the Mediterranean. He has composed and performed instrumental works and music for the theater and the cinema, for which he has received enthusiastic reviews. He has also written extensively on the evolution of the Mediterranean erudite musical tradition and its relationship to contemporary music. His publications include The Oud Teaching Method and his doctoral dissertation titled Post-Byzantine Music Manuscripts as a Source for Oriental Secular Music, 15th to early 19th century. Dr. Kalaitzidis is also the artistic director of the Thessaloniki World Music Festival and artistic advisor of the Cyprus Rialto Ethnic World Music Festival. Today's lecture will explore the common classical musical heritage of Byzantine ecclesiastical music and the music of the Eastern Mediterranean and its neighboring lands. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Kyriakos Kalaitzidis.
Sebasti Pateres, ladies and gentlemen, firstly, I would like to thank the Hellenic College Holy Cross and the Mary Hadjaris Center for Byzantine Art and Culture for this special, or for your special honor to invite me in order to participate in this so interesting festival. It is now accepted that in Mediterranean exists a common musical heritage which corresponds to Western classical music. Calling it Mediterranean musical heritage might be appropriate given that no universal usage has been agreed to amongst scholars. The geographical and political heterogeneous territory which became the historical ground for great civilization and empires is seen as musically uniform zone, with modality being the main connecting element. Although the boundaries of the territory and the extent of the cross influence, as well as their suggested interpretations vary, the existence of uniformity is now undoubted, despite the particularities and differentiations from region to region. In art music, in particular, in the last centuries, an important role appeared to have been played by Persian, Arab, Turkish, Greek, Armenian, and Jewish musicians, as well as those of other communities. Its roots are traced to antiquity in this region, rich in nationalities and cultures, which has politically and culturally unified for many centuries, and which was dominated for 2,000 years after the campaign of Alexander the Great by great empires, such as the Roman one with capital Rome, and later Constantinople, the Ottoman one, the Umayyad Caliphate, with its capital Damascus, and later with the conquest of Spain, with centers Cordoba, Seville, and Granada, the Abbasid Caliphate with its capital Baghdad, the Fatimid Caliphate with its capital Cairo, and the Persian dynasties of Sassanids and Safavids. Despite the wars, disputes, and traditional or incidental enmities, there was a free and perpetual movement, exchange and cross-influence of cultural customs and musical idioms. The large urban centers, and especially Constantinople, acted as a meeting spot of cultures despite the regional differences and singularities. At the heart of that musical world is the model system, which was shaped in antiquity with a solid theoretical foundation and which is the base of Eastern music, called makam in the Arab world and in Turkey, radif in Persia, and echos in Byzantine music, while very often common rhythmic patterns and melodic themes, forms and genres, sometimes repertoire, musical instruments and close interpersonal relationships and various collaborations and cooperations of musicians of different nationalities, which extended to the exchange of views and knowledge of on art and the musical scene are found. The musical manuscripts of ecclesiastical music comprise the most significant written source for the secular music of the East. This is evidenced by the volume of the sources, the time span, and the variety of genres covered, the ichi, the makans, and usuls contained with them, the composers' names preserved within them, and the wealth of information and inscriptions they convey. The chronological boundaries of the source material extend from the 15th century through to 1830, the year of publication of the first printed collection of secular music. Their existence gains particular importance from the fact that the rest of the people of the region, with the exceptions of the Armenians, had not developed a notational system until the middle of late 19th century, when almost concurrently, Arabs, Persians, and Turks adapted staff notation, devising extra modulation signs in parallel to represent the intervallic variety of their musical traditions. The quantitative evidence is impressive. 14 self-contained manuscripts, 12 fragments, and a large number of individual folios displayed within ecclesiastical music codices, altogether a total of 4,200 pages containing transcribed secular music pieces. The manuscripts bear witness to 53 named composers, including Greeks, Turks, Persian, Arabs, Jews, as well as many anonymous composers, as well with a total of approximately 950 works recorded within them. The main volume of the material preserves art music of Constantinople, both from the Ottoman court and Fanariot songs. Some compositions of Eastern origin, especially Persian art music, as well as a few Greek folk songs, are found within the manuscripts, and they also bring to the light previously unknown composition, a new version of already known pieces. Secular music transcriptions appear as a consequence of the appearance of the genre of kratimata, which also became the connecting link between ecclesiastical and secular music. In essence, the gateway through which secular Eastern music influenced the Byzantine melos. The notation of secular pieces was initially a fragment effort, evidenced in a few individual folios within ecclesiastical music manuscripts. From the 18th century onwards, however, the first self-contained anthologies of secular music were made, the main contributor to this development being Petros Peloponnesios. The secular music scribes are the very same as those that created the Byzantine music codices, Protopsalte and Lampadari of the Ecumenical Patriarchate, music teachers or Hieropsalte, and clerics of any rank, monks and laymen. In the case where prominent personalities were involved in the production of the manuscripts, the credibility and value of the transcriptions is increased. A significant number of codices were produced in the context within workshops of the monasteries of Mont Athos especially during the 16th and 17th centuries, as well as in Constantinople and the Dunabian principalities, in the two centuries that followed. Petros Peloponnesios is both prominent and iconic. He compiled the first self-contained collection of secular music in manuscripts Gritsanis III and Library Konstantinos Psachos 60 and 137 and Romanian Academy Library 927, where he preserved the largest volume of the instrumental repertoire of the music of the Ottoman court. He was the first to present each composition with its makam, usul, and zendr, while at the same time recording a multitude of composers. Lastly, he seems to have introduced the genre of Fanariot songs, and it was he who compiled their first anthology. The notation of secular pieces was motivated by the enjoyment, the aesthetic pleasure, and the love of learning of the scribes. Along the way, the transcriptions and the related extant manuscripts influenced musical practice in the Psaltis arcs, creating the conditions enabling new opportunities for their utilization. Their natural consequence was the systematic transcriptions made by later music teachers, as well as the printed music collections, the first being Efterk in 1830. From the early 19th century, secular music anthologies were seen as a really usable practice teaching tool within the Psaltis arcs, but also within their surrounding musicophile circles, where the teaching of secular pieces was integrated into the music education program. The study of the corpus of the transcription in relation to texts and sources of the Psaltic world from the 19th century leads to important historical and sociocultural conclusions, thus revealing the spiritual awakening and extroversion of modern Hellenism in the year after the fall of Constantinople. The material, although appearing heterogeneous at first sight, must be seen in the context of the Psaltic world regard to Eastern music as being akin and familiar. According to their aesthetic knowledge, the Psalter and scribes understood Eastern music as part of their Byzantine and post-Byzantine heritage. There was a widespread perception that the non-Greeks preserved many elements of Greek music in their musical traditions. The Psalter and scribes were rather convinced that Greek music influenced and defined the birth and development of the related traditions of the East. This conviction is expressed emphatically in sources of 19th century, a period that offers a satisfactory number of texts shedding light into the ideological framework and the motivation of the transcriptions. This, however, did not hinder them from composing patriotic songs with revolutionary content, which are found in the late 18th century and early 19th centuries, a time of national awakening. With regard to musical form, the sources bring new evidence to light, broadening our knowledge of musical form, naming conventions, and many other topics. Trends and developments in various time periods are observed, encompassed in the four centuries of manuscript tradition. The sources preserve Greek folk songs, genres of Ottoman court music, Fanariot songs, and compositions of undetermined form. Greek folk songs are of particular value and present similarities in their melodic behavior, musical form, and language style. These characteristics, in conjunction with their chronological proximity to the fall of Constantinople in 1453, allow the statement that they are probably purely Byzantine songs or, at the very least, heavily influenced from the Byzantine period. At the time of the creation of the manuscripts or of the three songs, of these songs, folk songs in general were characterized by longer melodic lines compared to contemporary folk songs, which were transmitted by oral tradition and subsequently recorded as audio or notation from the late 19th century onwards. The genres of the music of the Ottoman court can be distinguished as either instrumental and vocal, and there are 144 psrefs, 45 instrumental semis, 12 taksims, 21 seis, 9 chars, 38 bestes, 27 vocal semis and 36 sarkis, preserved in Byzantine parasemantiki within post-Byzantine musical manuscripts. The contribution of the sources towards a deeper understanding of these sense is twofold. The discovery of the new works broadens the corpus of the repertoire at the same time enriches the available knowledge regarding their musical form. The sources provide information about the layout of their sections and the structural entities comprising the zents as well as the particular type of zents. The Fanariot songs comprise a special genre of Neo-Hellenic artistic creation. They are songs which are commonly called Fanariot due to the fact that their composers and poets lived in the suburb of Fanari in Constantinople or came from there. The assimilation of Arabic makams and their combination with Byzantine ichi and with French poetic styles resulted in an interesting production. Around 1770, Petrus Peloponnesios wrote the first musical anthology of Fanariot songs, and from what it seems, he composed the oldest one of them. Fanariot songs exist in a great variety of makams, but in a small number of rhythmic styles. The vast majority of theirs songs are in Sul Sofian, even through there also songs in Duyek, Yuruk Semai, Aksak Semai, Frangi, and others. Their form is generally of small extent, consisting of two parts, the second part acting essentially like the mian in the vocal sense of the art music of Constantinople. Fanariot songs give more weight to the verse of comparison to the music. The body of transcriptions also contains a number of works of undetermined genre and or tradition, for which certain findings are preserved depending on each case. Interesting details are presented on the use of makam during the examinate period, as well as on the correspondences of ichi and makams, and function of the rhythm cycles, usul, in composition. The study of the corpus of surviving vocal genres of Eastern music find that they contain is blessed with non-lexical syllables corresponding to the Byzantine kratimata, which do not convey any meaning, rather give the voice the ability to improvise without the restriction of the poetic text. Their use is universal in the extended genres of Kyar and Beste, while they are only used occasionally in Agir Semai, Yuruk Semai, and Sarki. Terranum is also found in one of the works of undetermined genre, in which all its parts are identical, in the folk song Hereste Kambi Hereste, and in the following compositions, like Persicon of National Library of Greece 2401, Tasnif Persicon by Abukladir Merai from Limonos 259, and some others. The terenu syllables are found either with or without meaning. Listed in the table as an example are some of the syllables found in Eastern musical genres. Their use in the East is documented from the 16th century at least, but their origin is unknown at present. In the literature on Eastern music, they are generally referred to as a genre of terenum. The term is of Arabic origin. Taranim is the plural of tarnima, meaning hymn or song. It has been determined that the similar syllables of tananim, tananin, etc. were used in Persian classical music from the 11th century for the comprehension and teaching of the rhythmical cycles, and after the 16th century were replaced by the dum, teke dum, etc. of the Ottomans. Their use in composition is not witnessed prior to the 16th century. That is, they were exclusively confined to the areas of theory and teaching. From the 16th century onwards, they are found in various forms. Though they are never developed into an autonomous genre and happen in Byzantine music, A possible explanation is given by taking into account the fact that the neighboring non-Greek peoples had no such need, since instrumental music occupied as a dominant place in high culture. At first sight, the similarity between the names Terenum and Terirem, as well as between some of their non-lexical syllables in use in Eastern music, and those of the Kratimata of ecclesiastical music are obvious. From the above, as well as by examining the way that they were used in the available vocal compositions, the following findings are obtained. The two categories of terenum, that is, those with and those without meaning, resemble the mathemata and the anagrammatismi of the Byzantine melopoeia. It is observed that the main full syllabs extended the melody by repeating and varying certain syllabs of the poetic text, as occurs in the ηχήματα. The terenums play a regulatory role within the structure of vocal composition, as is in the case for the κρατήματα in Byzantine melopoeia. The parts of each composition are separated by terenums. This phenomenon is seen universally in Chiars and Bestes, and to a smaller extent in Aïr and Eurixemais. Reference must be made here to the relevant sections concerning the transcribed Chiars and Bestes, which are the most elaborate musical genres of the Eastern music, as well as those works of undetermined genre, all of which were mentioned above and are examined here below. Among the pieces of Eastern origin, there is also a Greek piece, the Hereste Cambi Hereste, from Iviron 1189. In its poetic text, a terenum is inserted with syllabs that are not in Greek but in Persian. Given that κρατήματα, at least of this form, are unknown in the Greek tradition, as is their insertion within the musical and poetic text, it is speculated that it is an excellent example of cross-cultural exchange. The piece, labeled Persicon, in Codex National Library of Greece 2401, as well as the Tasnif Persicon of Abdulkadir Marai from Limonos 259, enable the shifting back in time of the date of the first use of the terenum in art music traditions of the East by at least one century, to the 15th century. Two κρατήματα explicitly bear the title Pesrefi, a term clearly referring to the genre of the Pesref, and not simply a title related to secular music, such as the name of a musical instrument. For that reason, they are discussed there, their relationships to the genre of Pesrefs, remaining an open question. Karikis' composition is found only in three manuscripts, while Bereketis is found in a multitude of codices, one instance being an exegesi by Hormuzius, a fact that allowed a more analytical examination. No foreign or other syllables are found in their music score, apart from those commonly used in the κρατήματα of ecclesiastical music. Moreover, a Pesref form is not discernible. Instead, a typical three-part layout of a κράτημα with two νενανισμοί and one extended intermediate τερερισμός is evident. There is still a possibility that these two pieces are in some way associated with secular music. However, it's no case do they present the characteristics of the form of a Pesref or any other secular genre. Their character and melodic development place them clearly in the corpus of ecclesiastical music. The term Pesrefi in their title was perhaps the result of a widespread customs for many κρατήματα to be given names pertaining of secular music. However, this melding of concepts, namely of the genres of the Pesrefs and κρατήματα, motivated a further investigation into this issue. Pesrefs and κρατήματα come from the two different musical worlds. The Pesrefs constitute the crown jewel of the instrumental repertoire of secular music, while the κρατήματα are the pinnacle of Byzantine melopoeia, from the point of view of the artistic listening experience. However, both zens have certain attributes in common. A first observation is the common custom of giving a name to the composition, a rare practice in the rest of the zens of both secular and ecclesiastical music. Moreover, prashrevs and kratimata are noticeably different from the tradition each belongs to, since such traditions were certain on the serving the poetic text in the musical practice and production. A main characteristic of both is their instrumental nature and independence from the text, which results in more freedom in terms of the melodic wording of the piece. Nonetheless, the most interesting fact is that the origin of the Peshrevs are found in the genre very familiar to Kratimata, the Terenum. According to Owen Wright and Walter Fellman, in the Timurid period and during the 16th century in the Ottoman court, the Peshrev must have been performed as a vocal genre, with special syllables of the Terenum style, and developed into a purely instrumental genre in Turkey during the early 17th century. Similar information is also given by Edun Serusi. Jewish manuscripts from Turkey preserve the use of Peshrev as an actual vocal genre from the late 16th century, even though poetic text is used there instead of non-lexical syllables. Both in Theophanes Kariki's time and a little later in time of Petros Bereketis, early 18th century, the Peshrev still exist as a vocal genre, with the defining structure discussed above. Whatever the inspiration of these two composers from the secular music of the time during the composition of their kratimata named Peshrevi, it emanates from the vocal genre, related to the genre of kratimata, and not from instrumental Peshrevs in the form they are known today. The above, in conjunction with the discussion on kratimata in the section about Peshrevs, support the hypothesis of a significant cross-influence between the art music tradition of the Eastern Byzantine ecclesiastical music. Given that, the work of Grigorios Anastasiou has now provided a clear picture regarding the appearance and evolution of the genre of kratimata from the late 13th century and definitely from early 14th century, it can be reasonably speculated that in a known place and time and under undetermined circumstances, an osmosis took place in the broadening framework of relation and cross-influences between the psychic art and the musical tradition of the Near East, which not only affected the course of development of the Peshrevs by giving it characteristic attributes of the kratimata, but also defined the form of the vocal compositions. To the above, the traditional use of the terms of secular music to name kratimata such as Nai, Nagmes, Peshrefi, Tasnif, and others can be added. However, a link was found during the study of the kratimata bearing the name Peshrefi. All of these points justifiably lead to speculations and theories of a common origin. Additionally, it seems that prior to the 16th century and now prior to the 15th century, according to the sources examined here, the Terenum was not used by the Eastern nations. The use, however, of non-lexical syllables such as Tananin, Tanatin, etc., by the Persians for the comprehension, memorization, and teaching of the Usuls, already in existence in the 11th century, leads to the hypothesis that the appearance and evolution of the Kratimata and the Terenum are somehow related. The existence of non-lexical syllables in the Persian tradition perhaps became the motivation or even the inspiration of the use of similar non-lexical syllables by the Byzantine composers in the body of the musical text, while in turn Persian, Ottoman and Arab composers along the way adapted the Byzantine practice of using non-lexical syllables in composition, as well as their function as a regulation section with a form of vocal composition. And a final example of relationships is the Tasnif Persicon of Abdulkadir Merai, preserved in Limonos Monastery in Lesbos Island, in Greece, manuscript 259. The term Tasnif is found many times in Mysore tradition as a name in Kratimata, such as that of Chrysaphis in Ichos Protos. As well as this, the term is known from Persian art music. However, in Meraï times, the term tasnif was used to refer in general to the genre and not some specific form. This piece is particularly extended as it occupies 4 pages of score in the old notation. The first 2.5 pages are in Ichos first, and the other 1.5 pages are in Ichos second, with intermediate transitions to other ichi. The form, discerned by examination of the score, is this. You can recognize the teranum that is kind of separating each part. This is a unique example of notated secular composition from the 15th century, and its importance for that reason is great. Manuscript Limonos 259 account that the original manuscript, of which it is a copy, was written by Mr. Gerasimos of the Xanthopoulou Monastery by order of the great master. It is worthwhile to attempt an investigation into the identity of the person referred to in the manuscript as great master. The evidence at hand is, firstly, the title great master, and secondly, the scribe, Mr. Gerasimos of the Xanthopoulou Monastery. The title of great master was associated with the highest official of secular authority, the emperor in the Byzantine Empire and the sultan in the Ottoman Empire. Therefore, it can be assumed that it refers to either an Ottoman sultan or one of the late Byzantine emperors. Unfortunately, there is no adequate evidence about Mr. Gerasimos or about the Xanthopoulou Monastery, which possibly lead to the dating of the original manuscript, as well as to the identity of the great master who ordered this particular transcription. Since the operation of the monastery ceased after the fall of Constantinople, it is reasonably concluded that the original of Limonos 259 was written before 1453. The emperor, who might have heard the aforementioned composition in the first half of the 15th century, were the Paleologi Manuel II, Ioannis VIII, and Constantinos XI. From those, the focus of the investigation can be turned to Manuel II. I'm sorry. Broadly educated, intellectual, well-traveled, and having diverse interests, he fits the personality of a great master who could order the transcription of a work by the greatest of non-Greek musicians. Moreover, it's possible that this particular song came to this attention during his stay in the court of Sultan Bayezid I in Bursa, even though that stay does not coincide with the period when Marayi may have lived in Bursa as a court musician. Being the emperor, Manuel was followed by at least a small entourage, of which it can be excluded that Mr. Gerasimos was a member. It is also known that Manuel had a close connection with the Xanthopoulou Monastery, since Makarios, the abbot of the monastery, was his spiritual father. In any case, the inscription is worth noting, since it shows the interest of the emperor himself in the music of non-Greeks and make this particular work the earliest transcription of secular music, dating from the late 14th century. All those open lots and diverse issues that I believe they have to do with all of us who have been devoted to the study of this great common musical heritage. Repertoire, morphology, theory of music, makam and usuls, as well as the study and analysis of the reason and the causes that lead the writers to this impressive work, meaning and continuum within time chronological output, the perceptions of the writer, the sociocultural context, and so many others. Thank you very much. I apologize for my voice and my mistakes in pronunciation. So
at this point, we'll take questions for Dr. Kalaitzidis.
Father, according to what you say, the heterodynamic genre, which is a musical genre with non-lexical syllables that we have in Tzimtzum music, you think that it perhaps came from Persian music, in other words, non-lexical syllable, syllabic music being used in Persian. And the question is, I think it's a crucial question, maybe you told us why, but I didn't catch it. Why were they composing these kinds of non-lexical songs, melodies? How do they interpret? What do they mean to the Persians? I mean, is there a reason for that genre to come up, and then it, in turn, influence the Byzantine music?
Thank you for the question. What I said is that probably Byzantine teachers, musical teachers, took the idea of non-syllabs, using non-syllabs, non-meaning syllabs in musical text, because what we know clearly is in Persian art music. Thanks to the book of Abdulkadir Marai, who was a great figure of Persian art music. Abdulkadir Marai, in his book, used these non-meaning syllables just for teaching rhythms, not in the musical practice in composition. So probably they just took the concept of using non-meaning syllables in the music, and they adapted, they created the genre of kratimata. But because I have to say that the use in Oriental music, the use of kratimata of terenum in Oriental music is very limited. They offer even in the biggest genres like Kyar, not more than 3-4 lines of terenum. In Byzantine music, as we have not only long kratimata, long section of kratimata in pieces, but we have also autonomous genre of kratimata. And from 16th century, if I'm not wrong, please correct me, we have autonomous codices. From 16th century, we have autonomous codices of kratimata, kratimatarium, that have all kratimata. So it's a really very rich tradition, the kratimata in Byzantine music. But what is very interesting for me, it's what's also the title of my lecture saying, that's the cross influence. This is very important for me. That is a message for nowadays to our region.